So this is a very young idea. We created it just this summer at Singularity University. But we stumbled upon something that we believe can be a paradigm shift. So we want to solve for physical transport. 1 billion people in the world today have no access to all-season roads. That means that 1/7 of the Earth's population is disconnected from all social and economic activity for some part of the year. You cannot get medicine to them. They cannot get consumer goods. They cannot get their goods to market in order to create a sustainable income. If we look in sub-Saharan Africa, for instance, 85% of roads are unusable in the wet season. Only 12% of roads are paved. The quality of roads is going down. It's worse today than it was 20 years ago. Investments are being made, but at the current rate, it's estimated it's going to take Africa 50 years to catch up on road infrastructure. In the developed part of the world, we have very elaborate, very complex, expensive infrastructure. In the US alone, we have more than 4 million miles of roads. Now, mainstream thinking suggests that the developing world should go through the same stages of building road infrastructure we went through. We want to question that. We're asking, is there a technology that can help us put a solution today that can help those countries leapfrog? Imagine this scenario. You're in a maternity ward in Mali in 2014, and you have a newborn in need of urgent medication. Today, you would place a request by mobile phone and hope that the medicine arrives on time. Sometimes it takes hours or even days to traverse bad roads. We believe we can deliver it within hours or even minutes with an electric, autonomous medical supply vehicle such as this. This carries a small payload, about 2 kilograms, over a short distance, about 10 kilometers. But it's part of a larger fleet that forms an ultra-flexible automated logistics network that spans a bigger region, maybe even the entire continent. We call this the Matternet. The idea behind the Matternet is set up a network for transportation of physical goods that is based on the ideas of the internet. The enabling technology is UAVs. We want to harness all the great work that has been happening in academia and the open source community and build a platform that can allow us to do point-to-point delivery, decentralized, peer-to-peer, just like the internet. The second vital ingredient of the network is the automated ground stations we use. These are point stations on the ground that the UAVs fly in and out of in order to swap batteries and fly further or exchange loads. The third is the OS that runs the whole network, that optimizes routes, optimizes the flow of vehicles and goods through the system. It optimizes for weather conditions and guarantees the security of the system so we can guarantee to the authorities that it's not used for illegal purposes. Let's look at the technology in some more detail. The vehicle, that's a conceptual design of it, is a hybrid platform. It's based on multi-copter technology, such as this copter that we have over here. So this has vertical takeoff and landing. It is compatible with our concept of minimal infrastructure. It has a wing architecture that gives it a lift-to-drag ratio comparable to that of a helicopter. We don't need much. It flies at a speed of 40 kilometers an hour. It can fly in winds, up to headwinds, of 30 kilometers an hour. It is steered electrically, so it flies in the rain, and it flies at an altitude of about 400 feet. It's optimized for that. It could fly much higher, but that seems optimal from a regulatory perspective. And we want it to be friendly and safe, so we will deploy a parachute if we sense mechanical failure. In the heart of the vehicles, we have the interchangeable packet and battery. So when this vehicle lands into the ground station, the packet is automatically swapped. We have a 10-liter packet that can carry 2 kilograms. Let's look at the ground station. That's a conceptual design of it. The main job of the ground station is to create a safe harbor for the vehicle to go in and land safely. The vulnerability of the whole mission is the docking part, where you exchange loads and batteries. So we want to guarantee a safe environment for that. This happens in the upper part here, where it's a sphere, the vehicle goes in and lands and docks safely. The ground station acts as a commercial exchange hub. So someone comes into the ground station, they insert a packet, it goes up, waits in the dock, a UAV takes it to the next ground station, and it goes to the destination. We fly mainly using GPS, sensor fusion, IMU, pressure sensors, and magnetometers to guarantee that we can fly even if we lose GPS for a while. And the idea is that we upload GPS waypoints at the departure ground station. When we are in the vicinity of the destination ground station takes over with ultra-wideband sensors and camera. It brings the vehicle in the harbor, and then we dock it with millimeter accuracy. So we think we have a big idea, and we have the technology to make it happen. The next big question is, what's the cost? Well, it turns out that the cost to run a mission, what we call a mission, which is 2 kilograms over 10 kilometers, is 24 cents. Can you believe it? When we saw that, we understood even deeper in our hearts that we are sitting on a paradigm shift. Let's look at the costs behind this. The cost of the vehicle is $1,000. We can believe we can achieve it with heavy industrialization. We have a few trends playing in our way, like battery costs. Maintenance is minimal because it has only 4 moving parts or 6 moving parts according to the number of propellers. And it can have a lifetime of 10 years. The cost of the ground station, 15K, again, lifetime of 10 years. This will drop substantially as we go through more iterations. Now, cost per mission, 2 kilograms over 10 kilometers, for the vehicle works out to be 3 cents. Battery is 9 cents. We need to replace it every 600 cycles, conservative estimate. That estimate will go, that cost will go down significantly. Ground station, 10 cents. Energy for flight, the counterintuitive bit, only 2 cents. If we want to run on solar, the plan is to run in places that don't have grid energy, we need to triple that component. The last one. So 24 cents. What can we do with this? We started looking at the problem of HIV/AIDS delivery in Lesotho. Lesotho is a very particular case. It's a country which is very mountainous, surrounded by South Africa. They have an AIDS epidemic that is threatening the whole country with extinction. Over 500,000 people have the HIV/AIDS virus there. 70% of them live in rural areas. So we have 400,000 people who need to be tested twice a year to continue receiving the medication or make sure that they trace the virus early. They try to organize this collection of blood samples through 152 clinics, 19 hospitals with labs. They cannot get enough people to run the samples from the clinics to the labs. And there is recently we've been reading about the president's office initiative to use ponies to do it. Well, we have pony UAV to do it. Blood sample from hospital, from clinic to hospital is the problem. Results from and medicine from hospital to clinic. We set up a mini Matternet, and we wanted to get our idea, an idea around cost. We looked at the region of Maseru, 47 clinics there, 6 labs, 138 square kilometers. The cost to solve the problem there is less than $1 million today. $1 million, according to the World Bank, is the cost of constructing a 2 kilometer, 1 lane road. Can you believe it? This is, we believe, the power of a new paradigm. Now, when we realized what we are creating, we thought, okay, if it's really a paradigm shift, there ought to be more access. You know, there ought to be other places where this can be working on. I mean, the internet doesn't know boundaries, right? So we focused on the opposite scale of the problem, not where we don't have infrastructure, when we have a lot of it and it doesn't quite work. So 500 million of us live in megacities. China is adding a megacity to the city of New York every 2 years. It's not going to be something that this future of people living in the cities is only going to be more and more evident for us in the next few years. Let's look at Sao Paulo. 21 million inhabitants, 6 million cars. It's typical for people to get stuck in traffic 3 to 4 hours a day. The estimated cost of the government of congestion is $2.3 billion. The economy needs to flow, of course. In order to move goods around, they're using 250,000 motorbikes, courier bikes. There's a huge social problem around it. People are killed on the street every day. There is 500 people on average a year killed out of in relation to motorbike activity, either pedestrians or bikers themselves. More than that, it's not a scalable solution. It's not a modern solution for a country and a city that is having explosive growth like Sao Paulo. We believe we can solve the problem better. We can plant stations at the rooftops of buildings or even the sides of office buildings. You know, we can have an infrastructure that works 24/7, round the clock, just like the internet. So that's our vision. Matternet will do for physical transportation what the internet did for the flow of information. We have this concept called the bandwidth, which is material transported through the system per unit of time, and we think that's going to go up dramatically. We have a part of the economy, we think, that is not currently expressed with current means of transportation. We think if we add a layer of transportation that is dematerialized between the internet and the road, we can create something that is a new paradigm. Are there any challenges? Of course, legal, business. You know, there's going to be public perception issues. It's called changing the world. Is it worth it? We think absolutely. Thank you.
Let us define X. X is a solution to a seemingly insurmountable problem, like climate change or cancer, one that affects the world. But what if we redefine X as a challenge, an opportunity for radical thinking, a chance to light up the world with breakthrough ideas and cutting-edge technology, the stuff of science fiction that just might fly after all? Solving for X requires wonder and imagination and the vision to build seemingly impossible solutions to the world's biggest problems. Solve for X. Moonshot Thinking.